Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
It's a joy to be able to greet one another on that Easter note as we gather and worship here at our Savior. I welcome you very warmly on this lovely day and a beautiful summer light weekend seems to be upon us as we look at this month with all those special celebrations that are a part of it. Just a joy to be able to sit back and relax a little bit. So I am thankful that you are here. I'm thankful that Pastor Caleb and Tara and their family took the opportunity to get away on a little vacation. So he's not here this weekend. I'll bet he's listening in. The family's probably listening in. By the way, welcome everyone who is worshiping with us at home. So thankful that live stream can make that capable for you and for me and for us to be together, whether you're at home, there, or here in the pews. The family of faith gathers today for the purpose of simply being at home with Jesus. That's kind of the theme for today, actually. Taking a little transition here in the month of May, and the encouragement today is just to sit back and relax in God's grace and open up and listen. We hear these wonderful words that I think all of us need to hear, and it won't be the first time you hear it this morning, where God says, I love you, and it's going to be okay. Whatever it is that you may be going through, God loves you, and it's going to be okay. We're taking our cue from the gospel reading today in John 15, where Jesus identifies himself as the vine, and we as the branches, taking a closer look at what it means to abide in Christ. You should have received upon coming in a half sheet that is actually our opening hymn. Maybe most of you know this very, very well, but in the possibility that it's a new hymn for a lot of folks, until we get these hymnals back in the pews, which I can't imagine is too terribly long off, this should help, particularly if you enjoy reading music, so you might pull that out. And I do want to remind everyone that we want your prayer requests. That too. I think a few racks are going to have these things available sooner than later. But we want your prayer requests, and they're located, these little forms are located on the back pew, on our welcoming counter. And just to fill those out, hand them to someone, bring them up to me very informally. We want to be able to include your special prayers in congregational prayers today. So again, very grateful to be together. I invite you to stand as we begin on that glorious Easter hymn, Jesus Lives, the Victory's Won.
Thank you.
Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. We take a moment to come before the Lord in honesty and repentance. Let us confess our sins to God our Father.
I confess, God Almighty, before the whole company of heaven, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed by my own grievous fault. Wherefore, I pray, God Almighty, to have mercy on me, forgive me all my sins, and bring me to everlasting life.
Spirit, you will not gratify the desires of your sinful nature. The
The sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They're in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissension, faction, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and its desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand in respect and reverence for the words, the life, and ministry of Jesus, the Holy Gospel, according to John, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said, "I am the vine, the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch of mine that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself, unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. The branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. We'd invite Eric Bryan to come forward, a special moment and a children's message.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First, I have to say I'm sorry. That was me that shut the screen off up there. So forgive me on the first song. Luckily, you know, I had to use the paper to sing the song. But perfect. Yeah. Anyway, to the gospel. Do I have a couple children volunteers for me? Any children volunteers out there? I need two. Anyone? Nothing hard, you just need to stand up here. That's all. No? Oh, I see one's coming up. Can I get another one? Is we get cut off, right? And maybe I'm holding this one and this branch is still growing. But over here, these branches, they become sticks, right? Where do we find sticks usually? On the ground, right? Because they're not connected to anything. But a branch, right? A branch is connected. Still has life going to it, right? And so we can take a branch and we can see whether it's alive or not because it gets leaves or might get fruit on it, right? But a stick, we can wait a long time to see if we can see something come on that, right? And so in the gospel today, God's trying to tell us that he is divine, that we need to be connected to him. We need to be in his word, we need to pray, come to church, so we can stay connected so that we can live abundantly and live according to God's word. Hammer's done. You want my hand, Harper? All right. Okay? And so remember, the next time, maybe when you're taking a walk, or you're looking at a tree or a plant, okay, and see which branches are connected, compared to those that are sticks that are on the ground, that are dying and withering because they're not connected. All right? Amen. Thank you, guys. Amen.
Worshiping a lot outside, weather permitting. But motivating me personally for that and setting the stage for this idea of fortifying our Christian faith as it emerges from the book of Genesis are the gospel readings for the next several weeks, where Jesus helps us in very practical, simple, and even graphic ways to understand more clearly exactly who he is and who we are in relationship to him. And it is my sincere prayer that first and foremost, each one of us here, reflecting on these images that we'll be talking about, would in fact be drawn into deeper intimacy with the awesome Creator and Savior of the universe. So today in John 15, Jesus creates this first image for us. He uses a metaphor saying, "I am." And we don't want to miss this. "I am" is the same name of the burning bush of Exodus when the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob identifies himself for Moses as "I am." The Hebrew word, many of you know, is Yahweh. And here as Yahweh draws Moses into himself, promises him that as he goes before Pharaoh on this incredibly tough task, that it was going to be okay because "I am with you. I will be with you." And Moses, "It's going to be okay." Jesus says, "Yahweh." Same God as the burning bush. And then, the vine. Yahweh, "I am the vine. You are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in him bear much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing." Now we need to remind ourselves that this is Jesus' final moments with his disciples. This was on the night that he was betrayed. Those disciples didn't know what was coming. So Jesus proceeds to escort them out of the upper room, down the stairway, through the narrow streets of Jerusalem, out the eastern gate, down a path towards this area known as the Kidron Valley. And on their way, they pass through a vineyard, and Jesus just stops. And you can just kind of picture with me the disciples, very curious, starting to gather around him: Peter, James, John, Matthew. The sun is beginning to set on their faces. They have no idea that before the sun comes up again, their friend would be arrested. They had no clue that in less than 24 hours, their Savior would be crucified. They had no idea that the promises they had just made hours before would all be broken. But Jesus knows exactly what's going to happen. So what does he do here in these final moments, in this final conversation with his disciples? Does he say, "Buck up, stay strong"? Does he say, "Let's roll up our sleeves, it's time to go to battle"? He asks them to draw their weapons. "Let's roll." No. Looking around, he talks about a vineyard, one that they just happened to be standing in. And he says, "My Father in heaven is like a gardener, more accurately, a vintner. He plants the seed, he prunes and pampers the vine, prompting the best out of the vines. He wants the best fruit. He wants to bring the best fruit out of you. He wants to bring the best fruit out of me."
So notice here, first of all, how it is that this word picture is one where Jesus is in charge, God is in charge, and we're not. It's the first thing I want us to see. I want to ask the question, are you okay with that? God's in charge and you're not? You okay with it? And what if I were to ask you to raise your hand with me and say, I hereby resign from being the ruler of my life. God is in charge, and any fruit that happens is going to be His doing. Would you be okay with that? So Jesus is the vine. Jesus is the thick part. Jesus is like the trunk whose roots then burrow deep into the soil, drawing the necessary nutrients. And you can kind of picture this process as like the Holy Spirit, right? The rain coming down into the soil and the sun beating down, who then enables the vine to become the conduit through which the nutrients and the food then kind of get up into those branches. And that's us. And as this process works, as the Father is doing His cutting and His trimming and His weeding, and Christ receives the nutrients and the food and distributes them upwards, something wonderful happens. Fruit happens. The fruit of the Spirit that St. Paul will later talk about, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. All these wonderful things happen. And all of those desire those fruits, don't we? I do. But Jesus here says that the secret of being fruitful and bearing fruit is not forcing the fruit, but rather being connected to the vine. See, it does absolutely no good for me to do or for you to do. I've tried it before. Okay, today I'm going to be happy. I'm going to be patient if it kills me. Forcing fruit doesn't work. Clinging to the vine does. And this is something wonderfully freeing. Of all the things that Christ could have told His disciples that last night, of all the things that He could have had recorded for us on the night before the cross, the one thing that He wanted is for them to reflect back and for you and me to remember was this: you just hang on to me. You hang on to me as the branch hangs on to the vine. And unless we miss the point, Jesus employs the word abide. And He does so 10 times in 7 verses. That's significant. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. He who abides in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as the branch dries up. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. Abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and abide in his love. So, what's the key word here in this verse? It's not fruit. The key word is abide. Come and live in me. That's what abide means. Make me your home.
You know, we all abide somewhere, don't we? Home is where you relax, hopefully. Home is where you are more comfortable. Home is where you get something to eat, you get something to drink, you kick your feet up, right? Home is where you spend time with family, the people who mean the most to you. Home is a place to relax. Home is a place to unwind, to decompress, to get rid of stress. Home is a place to be yourself. You're not trying to impress anyone at home, are you? I mean, home is not where you need to show off. Home is a safe place for you and I to get built back up before we head back out. So Jesus is saying here to his disciples, and he's saying to you and me here today, he's saying simply, let me be that. Let me be that for you. Not a place where you have to perform in order to receive my approval. So I think very simply it just boils down to this, that our aim, our only aim, is to be at home with Christ. Be at home with Christ. We tend to miss this. I do. We tend to kick around phrases like, you know, I'm going to change the world. I'm going to make a difference. And don't hear me wrong, those are noble ambitions. In fact, I happen to relate quite well to people who talk like that. But the point I'm making today is that those are fruits. Fruits. Whereas a better statement would be this, for you and me to say, today I am going to connect with Christ. That would be a better statement. How do we do that? How do we abide in Christ? Well, I think we all connect in different ways. I think we all connect on different levels. After all, we're all different, right? We have different personalities. We have different interests. So there's not really kind of a one-size-fits-all answer here. But it will always include some common denominators. Ready? Scripture. Prayer. Finding a way to serve the Lord, using your unique talents, using your gifts, your heart. The Lord's Supper. By the way, is any of this sounding familiar? Fellowship. You know, the truth of the matter is, we're like grapes. We're better in bunches. We grow together, and we're actually more fruitful when we're together. And this is why the devil likes to try to tear you apart. Why he likes to try to tear us apart. Why he's trying to tear the country apart. Because he knows that we are more fruitful when we are together. So my encouragement would be, and the thing that kind of stemmed in my heart probably about midweek, is to encourage you to find a way to connect with Christ, the way that works best for you. And to remember that it's his invitation. This isn't something you have to force or create or foster. See, you're not trying to convince God to connect with you. It's the other way around. He's trying to encourage and trying to get you to connect with him. What happened in the Garden of Eden? He wants to replicate for us. He wants to happen again. Before the fall, Adam and Eve walked with God in the cool of the evening. No shame, no fear, complete joy. So when you wake up each morning, before getting going in your day. I read this, I see this, and it's saying just, and it's encouraging you and me to just open up and to listen. Open up and listen. God wants to greet you and me every morning with the words, "Why don't we do this day together?" Could you imagine starting your day like that? Why don't we live this day out together? Don't go on it at your own. Again, God knows exactly what's coming in your life. Before you go out, look up. He says, "You keep your ear on me, and I'll keep my eyes on you. I love you," God says. "It's going to be okay." I mean, how many of you need to hear that kind of a word from the Lord this morning? "I love you, and it's going to be okay." That is the joy of abiding. The highest call of a Christian is to make our home with Christ. And to the degree that we do that, I think we're happier. I think that we're more joyful. In fact, the best advertisement for Christianity is a happy Christian. Go figure. The worst advertisement for Christianity is the other, a miserable Christian. So last point, last comment. What would happen if each day this week you would simply wake up and your first thought would be this: "Today, I'm going to connect with Christ. Today, I'm going to connect with Christ." Trusting that He will bring the fruit at the right time and in the right way. God bless you and love you. All the way to glory. Amen. We're going to sing here two verses of a song that I think that's probably been racing around in a number of your minds and in your heart. And I would like for these two verses of the hymn "Abide With Me" to serve as the beginning of our congregational prayer time. So just sing them as a prayer. Why don't we stand? Sessions, as we, your people, have the privilege of praying for one another. So we hold up before you today Wade Webster, friend of Charlie Muir, diagnosed with cancer, starting aggressive chemo treatment. Pray for Jim Hintz, just continues to become weaker and eager to be able to get back on his feet. Pray for Wendy McGarvey. She continues to adjust and make changes and medication and deal with chemotherapy as she battles the cancer in her life. So Lord, as we now open up to you privately, the people that are on our hearts and minds the most, we pray for your healing touch, for your will to be done in their lives, whether it's physical ailments and issues or mental, emotional issues, even spiritual issues and illnesses, to hear these we hold up before you now. We'll give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Gracious God, in our special intercessions today, we pray for all first responders in our community to disasters and dangers among us. We pray for firefighters, paramedics, police officers, medical workers, men and women, especially those within our own church family, who serve from a sense of love for the community, who move toward risky situations to keep the rest of us safe and secure. Give them all courage and patience, Lord, as they carry out their duties. Protect them and assure them of your respect and your support, and more importantly, of your love and your grace. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So now as we prepare to head into this very special kind of pinnacle moment of our worship, I exhort you in Christ to give attention to the testament of Christ in true faith, and above all, to take to heart the words with which Christ presents his body and blood to us for forgiveness, that you take note of, and give thanks for the boundless love that he showed us when he saved us from the wrath of God, sin, death, and hell by his blood. And that you then externally receive the bread and wine, that is, his body and blood, as a guarantee and as a pledge. Let us then, in his name, according to his command, with his own words, administer and receive this testament. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the remission of all of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace and the joy of our risen Christ be with you all. Thank you. Take a moment to share that you need peace with one another as you feel comfortable in your families and you. You may be seated.
Thank you.
body and blood of our living and loving Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, be God's blessing unto each of you in the true faith, keep you steadfast in that faith and that resurrection hope until life eternal. Amen. So stand and prepare to close this time of worship and receive the Lord's blessing as we depart. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Starting that weekend. Hey, we enter the worship.
Yes, we enter.